Welcome back to our channel, students. Today in this video we are going to start a new unit called solid states. It comes under physical chemistry, so this is the third unit in physical chemistry. So in this chapter, first of all, let us go for the weightage of this chapter. According to the Karnataka PU board, the weightage for this chapter is 7 marks. Clear? So there will be one question of 2 marks and one more question of 5 marks. So totally there will be 7 marks question which will be asked from this chart. Clear? The same thing, 2 marks will be direct 2 mark question, whereas for 5 marks they can split up into 3+2 or 4+1. So this consists of 7 marks in case of board, whereas if you go for competitive exams like CET, NEET or JEE, maximum they will ask 2 questions, 2 to 3 questions, maximum 2 questions. Okay, so now let us see what all the concepts that we study in this chapter, solid state. First of all, we are going to introduce regarding solid state. You know about this solid states, and then the types of solids, amorphous and crystalline solids. And in this, we will be much focusing on crystalline solids itself. We do not focus much on amorphous, but we will be focusing more on crystalline solids. And then we'll go for the classification of crystalline solids, further classification of crystalline solids. And then we have concept of crystallides and unit cells, all are regarding crystalline solids itself. And we have voids and closed patch structure. Voids means the empty spaces which are present in the solids inside. Deeper in regarding this, and the packing efficiency, density of the substance, and we'll finish up with imperfections in unit cell and electrical and magnetic properties of the solid states. Clear? These are the concepts we will be studying in this chapter. Now if you go for the introduction to solid states. Yes, coming back to the introduction, you know generally there are 3 states of matter. One is solid, liquid and gas. Generally we have 5 states of matter, but to be simple we are focusing on only 3 states of matter, that is solid, liquid and gases. So on what factor does these 3 states of matter differ in? Here it is the temperature. Is it not? So for example, you have ICN, ICN is solid state. If you just heat it, that means if you just increase the temperature, it will be the same ice will be converted into water. And again, if you just increase the temperature, that means if you keep on passing the heat energy at that particular temperature, when the pressure is equal to the atmospheric pressure, that is your boiling point, water will be converted into its vapor. Clear? That is the state of gas. Clear? So these 3 are interconvertible. So if you just decrease the temperature, vapor can be converted into water, and if you still decrease the temperature, water can be even converted into ice. So these 3 solids, liquid and gases are interconvertible. So out of these 3, we will be focusing more on solid states. Why it is so? It is because in our daily life, we will be focusing, we will be seeing and we will be applying more solid states other than liquids and gases. We use liquids and gases, yes it is true, but mostly the maximum content is of solid states. Now just focus on the solid state itself. So you know that iron is also a solid. Iron is also a solid, plastic is also a solid, and glass is also a solid. Yes, it is 100% confirmed that iron, plastic and glass all are solid itself. But do they have the same property? This iron, plastic and glass, do they have the same property? No, it is not. Here, iron is very hard, it is very very hard to break, whereas plastic is soft, it can be easily broken. Here, whereas glass, it is hard. hard, but it is brittle. Clear? So iron is very hard. It cannot be easily broken. And whereas plastic is, it is soft. It can be easily broken. But whereas glass is, it is brittle. Brittle means it is hard, but it can be easily broken. So all these are solids, but why do they have difference in the environment? One is hard, one is soft, and one more is brittle. What is the thing which making the difference in their properties? It is the nature of constituent particles. It's clear, constituent particles means they may be atoms, ions, or molecules through which these solids are made up of. Based on the nature of these constituent particles and the behavior of these constituent particles, the properties of solids depends on. Clear? It's because iron is hard, it is because the constituent particle in iron is hard, whereas it is a plastic and glass. This nature of constituent particles decides the properties of that particular solids. Now, generally we can discuss the properties of solids now. Coming to the properties of solids, the first one is these solids have definite mass, volume, and shape. Regarding this, yesterday in a high school section itself, the solids have definite mass, they do have a definite volume, and they do have a definite shape. That's the first property of solid. And second one is intermolecular distances are short. Intermolecular distances are short in case of solids. For example, if you take sodium chloride, NaCl, this is an ionic solid. Here, Na plus Cl minus. This is an ionic solid because it consists of ions, and the sodium ion and chlorine ion. See, in these two ions, the intermolecular distances, these are the constituent particles of a sodium chloride. Here, what you get, the table salt or the normal salt, the constituent particles are ions in that case, that is sodium ion and chloride ion. So, these two ions, the intermolecular distances, means the distance between the two constituent particles, it may be ions. Maybe ions are in molecules. Yeah. See, these intermolecular distances generally in solids are very, very short. Clear? So, their atoms and molecules or the constituent particles will be very near. Clear? So, there's a meaning intermolecular distances are very short. So, intermolecular forces are strong. So, it is hard to break. So why it is hard to break solids? Generally, when you compare liquids and gases, it is generally hard to break solids. Why it is so? It is because of this intermolecular forces. Clear? Intermolecular forces mean the force of attraction or repulsion, the force of attraction between the two constituent particles. So the intermolecular forces are very strong. Why it is so? Because the intermolecular distances are very short. That means they are very, very near. As those are very near, those forces, they do have maximum intermolecular forces. So, it is very, very hard to break that intermolecular force of attraction between the two constituent particles. And that leads to the hardness of solids. Clear? There's a third. And they are incompressible. And rigid. Clear? See, liquids also, they cannot be compressed. Yes, I agree. But gases, we can. can compress it. Clear? You can just fill the gas, you can compress it, and you can fill the gas in a balloon itself, and if you just open it, it can spread over the entire room. So gases can be compressible where the solids are incompressible. They cannot compress solids. Clear? So these are compressible and rigid. And the last property of solids is the constituent particles are fixed and they can just oscillate in their main position. Clear? So the constituent particles, that is atoms, ions, or the molecules in solid state, they cannot move from one place to another place. Whereas in case of liquids and gases, they can move, but whereas in case of solids, they are fixed. They are fixed in only one particular position. But the only thing is, they can oscillate at their main position. They can show to and fro movement, that's all, and they cannot move from one place to another place. So these are the five properties of solids. One is they have a definite mass, volume, and shape, and the intermolecular distances are short. Because the intermolecular distance is short, the intermolecular forces are very strong, so it is very, very hard to break. There is a third property, and fourth one is they are incompressible and rigid, and they are not compressible, unlike liquids and gases. And the last one is the constituent particles are fixed and they cannot be movable. That means they can only just oscillate in their main position. These are the properties of solids. Now let's go for the types of solids. Types of solids. These types of solids are based on the arrangement of constituent particles. Clear? These types are based on arrangement of constituent particles. We have two types of solids. One is amorphous solids and the next one is crystalline solids. For example, amorphous solids, you have plastic, glass, etc. And in case of crystalline solids, you have gold, sodium chloride, diamond, etc. Now let us see regarding this amorphous solids and crystalline solids detail. So if you just observe the differences between these amorphous solids and crystalline solids, you get the clear information about these two. Now let us click in that row. Yes, we shall discuss regarding the differences between these two crystalline solids and amorphous solids. I have said you prior itself, we have divided these two types of solids as crystalline and amorphous based on the arrangement of the constituent particles. Clear? So the first difference is they have geometrical shape and they have irregular shape in case of amorphous solid. It means that when you focus on crystalline solids, so it is a long range order, we shall discuss later. Yeah. So this is the case of crystalline solid. That means they have very regular shape, they have very geometrical shape, their particles are perfectly arranged in this kind of regular manner. So this is in case of crystalline solids. Whereas we go for amorphous solids, they do not have a regular shape. That means the particles are arranged somewhat like this. Clear? So the arrangements are not clear. Very irregular arrangement in case of amorphous solids. Clear? You can easily observe this. This is in case of amorphous solids. This is in case of crystalline solids. Please. Do cooperate. I have a very bad handwriting in terms of diagrams, clear? So students, you can easily note that crystalline solids, they have a definite geometrical shape, they have a regular arrangement of the constituent particles, whereas amorphous solids, they do not have any regular shape of constituent particles. That is the first difference. So as I have written this diagram, let us focus on last one. They are anisotropic, that is crystalline solids, and then isotropic, that is amorphous solids. What is the property of anisotropic and isotropic? See, if you just focus on the physical properties of solids, that means whether it may be any refractive index or in case of electrical conductivity. Yes, let us take the electrical conductivity as an example. So when an electron can conduct electricity, that means when an electron moves from this end to this end, right? So if you just focus on this, it will cover all these constituent atoms, clear? So, but whereas it focuses, if the electricity is through this direction, it will cover maximum of only two constituent particles. So, clear? So, anisotropic means the physical properties will change. The physical properties will vary in some directions. It is not same in all directions, clear? We focus on top to bottom in this direction. The electrical conductivity will be more. It is because it touches more constituent particles. Whereas in case of this one, in this direction, it touches only two particles. So that means electrical conductivity will be very less. That means the physical property like electrical conductivity will vary through one or the other direction. So these type of properties where the physical properties will vary on any directions, we call it as anisotropic. So crystalline solids are anisotropic in nature, whereas isotropic means in case of amorphous solids, they do not have a regular arrangement of the constituent particles. So you can take from this direction, this direction, this direction, this direction, it doesn't matter. It will cover the average number of constituent particles. The physical properties like refractive index or electrical conductivity, whatever may be, in case of amorphous solids, they will cover the average number of the constituent particles in any direction. So the physical properties will remain same in all the directions. So that we call it as the property of isotropic. And now let's focus on the third differences between these two. Third difference is they have a sharp melting point, whereas in case of amorphous solids, they do not have a sharp melting point. For example, if we take gold, gold is a crystalline solid, that means if you take in a beaker, a piece of gold, and if you just heat it at that particular temperature, the boiling point of gold is 2700 degrees Celsius. At this particular exact 2700 degrees Celsius, the whole molecule, the whole particle of gold will boil. That is, the whole particle of gold will melt at particular temperature. That we call it as sharp melting point. Whereas in case of amorphous solids, you take example glass, or in case of plastics, the whole content will not boil at a particular temperature. Clear? So it will take. So there will be some x to y temperature. Yeah. For example, 20 to 30 degrees Celsius, they have that large gap, so they do not have a sharp melting point. And the fourth difference is they are true solids in case of crystalline solids, whereas amorphous solids we call it as pseudo solids. Pseudo means it is false, wrong. We have false solids we call it. Why it is so? Because crystalline solids almost they do have the property of a pure solid, whereas amorphous solids sometimes they behave as a liquid. Glass, if we just heat glass, the glass has the tendency to flow. Clear? So the tendency to flow is a property of a liquid. So we call that as pseudo solids are super cool liquids. Super cool liquids. super cool liquids. Clear? So we call them as super cool liquids. Why it is? Because I said you that when you heat glass, it has the tendency to flow. The tendency to flow is a property of liquid. So we call it as pseudo solids or super cool liquids. Coming to the last differences, the constituent particles have long range order, whereas in case of amorphous solids, the constituent particles have short range order. That means I have written a format here. Yes, so that format will continue in a very long range, but whereas in case of the amorphous solids, generally they will be irregular in shape, irregular in arrangement, so they do not have a long range order. So these are the five key differences between crystalline solids and amorphous solids. And in this video, we are ending up here. Let's continue in the upcoming video. Thank you.